Happy Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day, both to our audience here and to our online viewing audience as well. It's great to have you with us for our second night of Biotech 201. We have a lot of ground to cover tonight. Before we actually get to the medical genetics side, in honor of Valentine's Day, I thought we might actually start with why voles fall in love. And there is a biological basis, and this will tie us back to genetics, I promise. But I want to tell you a story about two different types of voles. Voles are rodents. They're small outdoor rodents that live in North America, and there are multiple kinds of voles. There is the prairie vole, and the prairie vole is the male and the female raise their children together. They mate for life, and the male protects the female from advances of other males. Now that's in direct contrast to a different type of vole, the montane vole and the meadow vole. The montane vole and the meadow vole are solitary. They live in solitary burrows. The genders live apart. The males are very promiscuous. They do not pick a single mate and stick with it. And they really have no interest in defending the female's honor. These are the bad boys of the rodent society. These are the playboys versus Mr. Right. Now, genetically, these voles are almost identical. So what is it about them that leads to such very different behaviors? So the answer comes down to two molecules, neuropeptides. Neuropeptides are small molecules, they're proteins, they're produced by genes. They only have about 9 amino acids, 9 building blocks, and these two are called oxytocin and arginine vasopressin. Now, oxytocin and arginine vasopressin are produced in the brain, and they're released by the pituitary, and arginine vasopressin and oxytocin have actions on different parts of the body. For example, oxytocin is what stimulates labor. It's what stimulates the uterine contraction. So if you've ever had Pitocin, well, men, you probably have not had Pitocin. Ladies, if you've ever had Pitocin to induce labor, that is the synthetic form of oxytocin. It stimulates uterine contractions. It's also involved in the process of lactation. But in addition to having actions throughout the body, oxytocin and arginine vasopressin actually also impact in the brain. They have direct impacts on the brain. And it's these impacts on the brain that account for the difference in the voles, the prairie vole and the montane vole's behavior. So here's the way this works. So male and female, female here in gray, male in brown, just to make it easy to identify. Before mating, they really don't have a whole lot to do with each other. After mating, arginine vasopressin and oxytocin are released in the brain and stimulate parts of the brain, and the vole, the prairie voles, fall in love, and they become monogamous. Now, you can scientifically administer or block arginine vasopressin and oxytocin in the rats, in the voles, and you get different responses. So the oxytocin is primarily what's active in the females, and the arginine vasopressin is primarily what's active in the males. So if the male is injected with vasopressin before mating, the male is head over heels gaga in love before mating. If after mating you inject a drug that blocks arginine vasopressin, the female is in love, but the male is like, whatever. He is a player. He's like, yeah, whatever. Love him and leave him. Now, for the females, if the female is injected with oxytocin before mating, She's like, you are my one true love. We will get married and have lots of children. And the male's like, huh? Now, after mating in a separate experiment, if you let them mate and you inject the female with a blocker of oxytocin, the male is like, will you marry me? And she's like, loser. Get a bigger house, get a bigger car, and then maybe we can talk. No, but so these neuropeptides, sorry. My moderators on the chat room are gonna have quite their hands full now. These molecules, these neuropeptides, these 9 amino acid molecules have major roles in how these voles behave, the way that they form attachments, the way that that their parenting styles are different. So both the montane voles and the prairie voles both release oxytocin and arginine vasopressin, but some work by faculty at Emory, so Dr. Larry Young and Dr. Tom Insel, who used to head the National Institute of Mental Health, I think I've got that right, he was at Emory before he left to head that group. They did work looking at prairie voles and montane voles. And what they discovered is if you look at their brains, here's the brain sections of prairie, here's the brain sections of montane, and you stain them to see what parts of the brain are the receptors that respond to vasopressin and oxytocin. What parts of the brain are those receptors found in? And they found that in the prairie voles, the oxytocin receptor is in a region called the nucleus accumbens. And in the male prairie voles, the vasopressin receptors are in the ventral pallium. And these are involved in reward and in reinforcement of behavior. The montane voles, the promiscuous players, actually don't have receptors in these same regions. So their brains are being stimulated by oxytocin and vasopressin, but different parts of their brains are being stimulated, not the parts of their brains that say, this is the vole that I want to spend the rest of my life with. So the locations of what parts of the brain are stimulated really is what seems to be the difference between the montane vole and the prairie vole, and seems to be responsible for this really very, very different behavior. So how about in humans? So remember, we've got our genome up here. And remember, each one of these notebooks, there's 100 notebooks. Each one of these notebooks represents 5,000 double-sided pages of genetic information, just to give us a framework. So in humans, we have the genes for oxytocin and arginine vasopressin. Every vertebrate has these genes. These genes are very heavily conserved across the animal kingdom. And they're located on chromosome 20. In fact, what's really interesting about them is that the oxytocin and the arginine vasopressin genes are 10,000 bases apart. So that's the equivalent of about 3 pages of information in our notebook between the two. That's how they are that close. They are neighbors. And remember, these are really short. They only produce 9 amino acid proteins, but they're right next to each other. So that's the genes that make the peptides. The receptor genes are located for the arginine vasopressin receptors on chromosome 12, the oxytocin receptors on chromosome 3. And there are genetic changes found across the human population in the protein-making genes and in the receptor genes as well. And there's been a lot of work trying to figure out if we can correlate those. Do changes seem to impact human behavior in terms of forming attachments, in terms of the way that they describe trust building and romance? The data haven't really borne out that the clear genetic relationship, that changes in the DNA lead to that, but that certainly hasn't stopped groups from looking at what this might mean for human behavior. So they found in about 2009 that if they gave intranasal injections, intranasal sprays of the oxytocin, people reported feeling more social. They reported feeling more goodwill towards their fellow men. They reported a higher level of trust, in some cases a higher level of empathy or romantic relationship. Now, if you have been to any of these before, you have heard me say correlation is not causation. But there have been a lot of studies suggesting that if you give people intranasal injections of oxytocin, something may change in their behavior. So you find a lot of press about this. Oxytocin, the love hormone, it's also called the cuddle protein, makes men in relationships want to stay away from other women. Well, not necessarily. But that hasn't stopped this really enterprising company from creating liquid trust. So for $29.95, you can put on some oxytocin, and as the people around you inhale it, they will trust you implicitly. Okay, big warning here. I would not recommend you invest in this, nor would I recommend you go out and wear this. You've heard me talk about this. Correlation is not causation. Not every finding is a real finding, especially if you can't replicate it. And the studies suggest that this is much more complex than what the initial work suggested. However, in spite of everything I've just told you, there is some really interesting evidence that both of these, but especially oxytocin, may be really helpful for individuals that have challenges in social cueing and functioning in social settings. Individuals that have social anxiety, individuals that have fears of large crowds, and maybe even some forms of autism, that this may help in the social interaction. So again, liquid trust it is not, but there may be something here that is a deep-seated part of our brain in terms of how we respond and the way we interact with each other and the way we trust and form relationships. All of which leads me to, you can't spell love without vol. So, yes. So to bring us full circle on Valentine's Day, we've now talked about rodent love. Is that muskrat love? Isn't that the song? Yeah. And DNA. There is your random bizarre fact for the week. Again, do not go out and buy liquid trust. Do not put it in your air vents at home. It is not the air freshener you want in your car. Okay, now let's talk about medicine. Let's talk about genomic medicine. We have a lot of ground to cover tonight, a lot of pieces that I want us to talk about. But first, I want to lay the groundwork for some of the diagnostic testing processes that you often hear when people say, I had a genetic test done, or they're doing genetic testing. It's kind of like hand waving, and some magic happens in a box. There are lots of different types of genetic tests, and I want to be able to cover what those tests are. I just want to give you a little bit of vocabulary. We're not going to dive deep into this. You're going to see prices down at the bottom. These are ranges, just to give you a ballpark idea of how much these different kinds of tests cost. But we need to understand the image that's on the screen behind me. So I'm showing you four chromosomes. In this instance, 1, 7, 18, and X, just as a representative sample of your genome. And you'll see that I've got all these boxes, and then some of them are the same color, and some of them are different color, and I've got boxes really close together and some boxes that are really far apart. Each one of these boxes represents a gene, that piece of instruction, your DNA, that tells your body how to make something. Generally, it's a protein. Sometimes it's a regulatory molecule. There's a gene, like we just talked about, for oxytocin. There's a gene for arginine vasopressin. Genes are divided up into bits of instruction separated by intervening pieces of information. This is called exons, and the instructions are exons, and the intervening pieces are introns. You can think of it this way. If you're online and you're reading your favorite news site, whether it's CNN, Fox News, the New York Times, AL.com, when you're reading an online story, there are ads in the middle. You'll read like two paragraphs, and then you get to an ad. And then you read three or four paragraphs, and there's another ad. And then a video plays, and then something else happens. And can you tell I'm not a big fan of that format? But you can think of your genes and in the same way. Your exons, that's the information you're reading. The introns are intervening. They're in between space. What you actually do is you splice out all the introns to get the full news story. So for example, when you print a news story, often all of the commercial pieces are pulled out and you get on one page all the news. Same kind of thing. Exons are the information, introns are the intervening other pieces that we're not going to worry about. You'll also see that I've got, in this instance, multiple purple genes and multiple red genes. So purple, purple, purple. These are related genes. So for example, collagen. Collagen is a protein that gives structure to your bones, and it's found in your earlobes and movie stars injected into their lips. There are multiple different kinds of collagens. Collagen 6, collagen 12, collagen 20. They're all a little bit different. There's a collagen 6 gene, a collagen 12 gene, a collagen 20 gene. The genes are pretty similar, very, very similar, but they've got a little bit of different information. That's part of a gene family. Okay, so there's our background. Now let's talk about different kinds of tests. You can have a biochemical test. A biochemical test tells you nothing about the DNA. It's looking specifically at the proteins that the genes make. So a biochemical test can indirectly tell you something might be going on genetically, but I'm not looking at DNA. So when we do certain blood tests and we're looking at protein levels in the blood, that indirectly may tell us if something's going on with our DNA, but it's looking at proteins. All right, now let's move on to tests that look specifically at DNA. The first one's called a karyotype. Every picture that you've seen where I've put chromosomes up here is a karyotype. You essentially stain, you apply an ink across the DNA, it binds across the chromosome, and it makes it visible under a microscope. So you actually get this kind of image where you've stained the chromosomes so that you can see chromosomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. That technology has been around since the 60s. That's the standard for years, for decades. That was the extent of our genetic test. And it told you broadly, do I have extra chromosomes? Am I missing chromosomes? But that was about the extent of what you knew. A microarray is a much finer level of resolution. Essentially, for a microarray, you have built little tiny probes that you know bind to a specific site in the DNA. And I think I'm actually showing you 56 of them. They're these little tiny pieces. There are thousands and thousands of these little probes in a true microarray. I'm just giving you a representative. And each one of those pieces goes and binds somewhere. And you're essentially looking to see, Did I have DNA that bound to that probe? In other words, was that region of DNA present? And remember, you've got two copies of all your chromosomes, so I'm really looking to see, do I have binding from the equivalent of two chromosomes worth of information? Microarrays let you get to a very fine level. You can see all the way down to, say, a million bases extra or missing, or maybe even a few hundred thousand letters extra or missing. And you can tell that because if it's on the next slide, if it's missing, and you may not have this slide, I can't remember if I put this in your handouts, but if it's missing, so see I've got a chunk missing here, I've got a probe that nothing bound to. And so I can say, oh look, this didn't bind, what part of the DNA does that represent? It must be missing. Or if I've got a duplication, I've got extra information, I've got binding in two different places. So microarrays are a much higher level of specificity. They were developed really in the 90s and really kind of became much more common in the 2000s. They are still in use today to give you a finer level of resolution. All right, now let's just say that you know that there is a specific letter of DNA that you want to find out if it's mutated or not. For example, individuals that have achondroplasia, That's a form of short-limbed dwarfism. So the long bones in their body don't fully, they develop at a much reduced size. So if you've ever watched the television show Little People, Big World, those individuals have achondroplasia. Everyone with achondroplasia has the exact same mutation at the exact same site in their DNA. So if I have somebody that I think has achondroplasia, I don't need to look at all of their genome. I just need to look at that one site. Does that make sense? I'm going straight to the source. So I can look at a single site test. I'm saying at this one site, do you have this nucleotide or do you have this nucleotide? Now there are other disorders where I know it's caused by mutations in only one gene. I don't have to look at the entire genome. I can just narrow in on a single gene, but there could be multiple different mutations. Individuals that have cystic fibrosis, they all have mutations in the same gene. It's called CFTR, but there are thousands and thousands of different mutations. So I may be using a panel to look at the 50 most common mutations. Or I may be looking at a disorder where I know that the mutations are spread out across three or four genes. And so now I'm looking at a panel of across these different genes, where are my mutations? But again, I'm not looking at the entire genome. I'm looking at more than one site, but I'm not looking genome-wide. I'm still relatively narrow in my scope. I could have so many mutations in a single gene that a panel isn't going to be effective, and I actually need to look at every nucleotide, every letter in that genetic recipe. So that's sequencing the entire gene. And I may be only interested in sequencing the exons, remember those bits of news on my web page. But there are a number of disorders where actually there are also mutations in the introns, in what I described as the commercials. And those mutations in the intron actually throw off the way the rest of the news is understood. So I may need to sequence the entire gene, exons and introns. Single gene test. Now I want you to look at this. Oh, I think I just erased it. Or maybe I didn't have it up here. These single gene tests can be $2,000 or $3,000 a gene. Just want you to remember that, $2,000 or $3,000 a gene. Now compare that to much broader technologies like sequencing panels. I'm going to look at all of the collagen genes, or I'm going to look at all of the genes that I think might be involved in common forms of cardiac disorders, common forms of heart problems. Multiple ones of those may be less, often are less, than if I were sequencing each one of those as an individual gene. So in other words, I may be able to sequence five genes for $5,000 as a panel, or five single genes one at a time for $2,000 each. So now the cost differential is beginning to shift here. I'm now beginning to talk about technologies where getting more information is cheaper than getting less information, just because the way the sequencing is done is cheaper when you're looking at large chunks as opposed to very, very targeted. I could sequence the entire genome. I'm looking at all of the genes. I'm looking at all of the intervening information. And you can see the price point up here is somewhere between $4,000 and $10,000. That's the cost of sequencing about, you know, 6 to 8 single genes. I can give you 20,000 genes plus all the intervening space. So this kind of approach is, from a cost standpoint, pretty impressive. But I'm also giving you a tidal wave of information to look at and to interpret and to sort through, which can be incredibly challenging. So there's a trade-off there. How targeted do you want to look versus how much other information? And as you'll find in just a minute, when I look at all of your genome, I have the potential to uncover things that were not what you originally brought in to ask about. Because now I'm looking at all your DNA. So you have to be willing to say, I don't want that information. I only want some of that information. I want all that information. And what are the impacts of that? Okay, let me stop and ask if we've got questions. Yes, sir.
You talked last time, Victor, about human testing. I had my chicken portion one. How do those tests compare or contrast in process and efficacy?
Yeah, so I talked a lot about ancestral testing last week, and you had your dog tested, genetically tested. And there are all kinds of companies that will test your dog, they'll test your cat, they'll test all sorts of different animals and tell you the what breeds your dog or your cat or your pet or your horse come from. Same kind of content. They look at differences in the DNA between the dog breeds. So there's not a whole lot of difference. Amazing to think about. There's not much difference between a Yorkie and a Great Dane. They've been bred, they've been selected for specific changes that lead to those traits, but it's really a handful of them. So you can look at specific places in their DNA and you can say, ah, I see the signature that's characteristic of a Great Dane or of a Sheltie or of a Peekaboo, and you pull that information together. Now, how accurate are those is a little challenging because not all of the genetics has clearly been worked out across the breeds. In general, though, they're pretty accurate. And if you sent your DNA in and said to the dog company, they would come back because they run some filters that would say, this is not a dog. So they do catch, because people do. People send that all the time. They send in chicken DNA and, you know, all those kinds of things. Mary.
Hey, so if a young, healthy person gives their entire genome sequence, how relevant is that information, say, 2 decades away, after environmental factors, they have changed some things, how relevant would that be?
That is a great question. So if a young, healthy person gets their genome sequenced, how relevant will that be 3 or 4 decades from now? So your DNA generally does not change drastically over your life. Now, there is an exception that we'll talk about next week, which is cancer, because cancer is an accumulation of mutations. But in general, your DNA is going to be pretty consistent, and that cancer accumulation is only in a subset of your cells. So the genetic information is relevant. The environmental influences that you will have been exposed to could be quite different. So your genetic risk for disease should stay constant, but the different environments you've been exposed to when you're 20 versus when you're 60 may tip the balance between you're just genetically predisposed to this disorder and you actually now have this disorder because of the environmental influences. The thinking is that having your genome sequenced is the one test that follows you throughout your life. Now, the really important caveat that I need to say is that our understanding of what's in your genome today is very different compared to our understanding in 30 years. So our knowledge of what your genome tells you will change, but by and large, your sequence is pretty consistent. Anybody over here on this side? Okay, anybody over here? Yes. Yeah. How do you analyze all of this information and the 4 to 6 million DNA changes that are going to be found in you? If you'll hold on for about 8 or 9, maybe 10 slides, I will get to that. Because that is a critical, how do we do this? How do we move forward? Okay, let me move us on. Let's talk about carrier testing. I'm going to talk about carrier testing really briefly because we're going to spend most of our time on diagnostic testing. Carrier testing specifically is talking about what are called recessive diseases. Recessive diseases are diseases that are present when both the gene on the copy from your father and the gene on the copy from your mother both have a mutation. So let me say that differently because I just really messed that up. Recessive diseases require 2 mutations to be present. A mutation on the copy you inherited paternally and a mutation on the copy you inherited maternally. But you see, each parent has 1 mutation and 1 typical copy. They're carriers. They don't have the disease, but if they marry or if they have a relationship with another carrier, they could each pass the mutation on and the child could have the disease. So carrier testing is saying, are you a carrier at any one of hundreds of different diseases? It's looking at lots of different diseases. You can't read it, but the list on the wall behind me over here is a subset of the different diseases. It probably looks like teeny tiny blue lines, is a subset of the diseases. Here's a blown up section of it that's a little bit easier to read. This was just, no, that's actually not easier to read, is it? So it includes things like congenital Finnish nephrosis, cystic fibrosis, congenital disorder of glycosylation, D bifunctional protein deficiency, diastrophic dysplasia. These are things that you've, except for cystic fibrosis, you've probably never heard of because they're really, really rare. But knowing if you're a carrier gives you insight, because if you are a carrier and you have a mating relationship with another carrier, there's a 25% chance your child will have that disease. So carrier testing, not surprisingly, is very heavily marketed to couples considering having children, especially now. It's relatively new, now that we have this technology that lets us look at thousands of genes. Now there are all these beautiful websites that show families with small children where everyone is smiling, and the tagline is something like, you want to know before you have children. Give your children the best chance possible. Find out. I needed to know answers. I needed to be certain. It's that kind of get the information so you can then make decisions before you actually have children. So that's the concept around carrier testing. There are lots of different groups that do carrier testing that you can send in and have carrier testing done. It's a few hundred dollars. It is not generally covered by your insurance unless there's a family history of the disease, unless there's a compelling reason to think that you might be a carrier. So for example, some of these, the frequency of carriers is 1 in 15,000. Your insurance company is not paying for something like that. But if you've got a family history, your insurance company may pay for that because that's important information to know. So that's carrier testing. Okay, I'm gonna get us to diagnostic testing. I'm gonna get us a couple slides in, and then I'm gonna pause and let us take our break. A break which I will say, thanks to the Jackson Center, has some Valentine themes around it. It is not chocolate dipped strawberries and champagne. We are a nonprofit. But there's a little Valentine's flavor in break. Okay, so diagnostic testing. If we were to look at patients that had a suspected genetic condition, so they have a set of symptoms that suggest there might be something going on here that has a genetic basis, and we were to look at karyotyping and microarray and single gene testing, which I described to you earlier, this gives you a sense of what percent of those patients. Karyotyping identifies about 5%. Microarray picks up another 17%. Single gene testing picks up about 20%. There's a pretty significant portion of the circle that's not filled in just with that level of test. But until recently, going beyond that was technically not feasible, and if it was feasible, it was prohibitively expensive. The cost has drastically dropped. I'll show you that slide in just a second. So now we can consider things like having your exome, looking at all of the information pieces of all of your genes sequenced. That adds another 15%. There's still a pretty large chunk where there's no diagnosis. A number of these patients get answers when we expand the search out beyond the exome and look at the genome and look at all of the information. That's a big reason why HudsonAlpha is a believer in genome-wide sequencing. Yes, it costs more money. Yes, it's harder to interpret, but it gives you a much broader sense of data, a broader set of data to work with. So there are some key components of genetic medicine, and I'll get into one or two of these, and then we'll stop for our break. Grab a quick drink of water. All right, The first component is being seen in by a physician, being seen in a clinical setting. We'll talk about what that involves. There is direct-to-consumer testing. You can order a genetic test online. A few years ago, you could order a genetic test online that gave you a lot of health information and never had to involve your doctor. The FDA is not a big fan of that. And shut that down. There's a real tug of war right now between proponents who say you should have access to your genetic data and shouldn't have to go through a physician. It is your own data. And people who say, yeah, but involving a physician, involving a clinical team really is the best idea, especially since this is, number one, still so new, has a whole lot of nuances, and what this really means in a clinical setting isn't 100% nailed down. It's not even 75% nailed down. So it'll be interesting to see how this works, how this, do you go through your physician? Do you just get the information on your own? Do you look at a company that has their own physician that gives this, that gives you consultation, so you are not just getting it without any kind of medical advice? This brings up a whole lot of education as well. You guys have been in a number of these sessions, so you're probably among the most savvy citizenry in the world on genomics. I mean that. I mean, yeah. Other people recognize that Huntsville is one of the most genetically well-educated areas in the world. But even still, I'm not so sure that I would be comfortable just handing your genome over to you and saying, okay, have at it, good luck. Remember everything we talked about. So how we play this out still kind of is still in process. So once your sample actually is obtained, then there's a whole set of steps that you have to go through, which we'll dig into, which is I gotta actually sequence the DNA. I have to interpret what the variance means, which comes back to your question, how do we figure this out? I have to then think about how do I incorporate this into patient care. What does this information mean for tomorrow? Which comes back to Mary's question about 20 years from now, how do I still gain information from this? And how do I incorporate this into the existing clinical framework of your electronic health record and how this information is relayed into other places like your insurance company or your other surrounding physicians and all those pieces? So these are all parts of the puzzle that we have to work our way through. First piece. Going to the clinic. So we have an amazing clinic on campus, the Smith Family Clinic. It's a partnership between HudsonAlpha, Children's of Alabama, and the UAB School of Medicine. And it is specifically designed to work with families who have been on an odyssey, a diagnostic odyssey. They've gone in and they had a karyotype, no results. They had a microarray, no results. They had a single gene test, no results. They know there is something going on, but they have not found a way to get an answer. And the Smith Family Clinic for Genomic Medicine starts with the sequence. So it looks at the patient, has a lot of clinical workup, looks at your past history, your past tests, and in many of those cases says, all right, I think there's enough evidence here to actually move forward and look at your genome. In some cases, we think that in the not too distant future, sequencing your genome should be the first test, not the last test. So I was talking about the Smith Family Clinic for Genomic Medicine. And here are the incredible staff of folks at the Smith Family Clinic. Actually, here's most of them. I just realized that there is one individual who's not on the list, so I need to fix that. But Carol Aiken, who's the clinic administrator, is in this group, and she's here with us tonight. Carol is in the very back of the room, and she's standing up waving. One of our genetic counselors, Kelly East, is also with us tonight. And Carol and Kelly are happy to have a conversation with you if you are interested in learning more about the clinic, if you've got something that you want to say, I think this might, does this potentially qualify? How do we begin this process? How do I get seen at the clinic? Carol and Kelly can walk you through what those steps are, and they'd be happy to. The folks at Smith Family Clinic for Genomic Medicine essentially are doing the equivalent of searching for not just a needle in a haystack, but a needle in a stack of needles. When you sequence through your genome, you are looking for that one change or that set of changes that gives you insight into understanding why the patient has the symptoms that they have. It is really exciting to have the Smith Family Clinic on the Hudson Alpha campus, but also here in Huntsville. And the goal, and again, in our partnership with Children's Healthcare and with UAB School of Medicine, is to figure out how we work this in a smaller setting and then apply it in the much larger university hospitals and ultimately someday in primary care as well. It's a lot of work to get to that point, but at some point, that's where we hope to find ourselves. Now the second component, so once you get you've seen the patient, is how do you actually get the sequence? How do you get the patient sample, like we talked about with the swab or the blood, and get the DNA, get the genome sequenced, or the set of genes or the sites sequenced? You have to find a way to do this that's rapid, economical, that's accurate, and that's comprehensive. At Hudson Alpha, we partner with the Hudson Alpha Clinical Services Lab that does the sequencing. And they're able to do sequencing because of the curve that I'm about to show you. So the cost to sequence the first human genome was about $750 million. That's not in your pocket. That's not in your couch. That's probably not even in your 401k. This is the cost curve to sequence a human genome from 2001, when it was about $100 million, to today, $1,200. Now, let me just be clear, that is to sequence. That is not to interpret. There is an interpretation cost. That adds another $6,000 to this, depending on the level of interpretation that you're looking for. But the cost curve has plummeted to actually get the sequence. That's why we've got places like the Hudson Alpha Clinical Services Lab that now actually does this work. They have access to these incredible machines, some of the best technology in the world, that rapidly sequence through your genome efficiently. And the Clinical Services Lab at the Institute is really known as one of the best places to get clean, high-quality data. And before you start analyzing it, you've got to have the cleanest data that you can. Garbage in, garbage out. So you want it wherever you go. And again, this sounds like a commercial. In some ways, maybe it is. But the reality is you can go wherever you want to get your genome sequenced. You just want to ensure that it's of the highest quality and that they're able to separate out, oh, this is the noise in the system. These are real DNA bits of information. So once you get the sequence, then you have to interpret it, which comes back to the question that you raised. So every single DNA variant, and if we were to sequence any of our DNA, we would get about 4 to 6 million variants. We get a slightly higher number of variants in African Americans. They come from a population that is evolutionarily older, that's got more variation in it. And because many of the projects done to date were done on Caucasians, we don't have a whole lot of information when we look at DNA changes in an African or an African American population to be able to say, oh yeah, that's seen a whole lot. That's just part of normal variation versus, I haven't seen that one before. We need to pay attention to that. Fortunately, there are more and more studies of those populations other than European Caucasian populations that are beginning to build in that set of data for us to analyze. But let me take a step. I started down this road and then took a side turn. 4 to 6 million variants for you and for me. So we have to now figure out what are the ones we really need to pay attention to, and we have to look at what's called the pathogenicity. How likely is this variant to be related to the set of symptoms that I'm looking at in my patient, or to be causative for disease later in life? And that's a combination of automated filtering, individuals writing computer code, programs that do this, that look at each DNA change and say, is that commonly seen in the population? Is that seen across multiple different organisms? Is there an evolutionary conservation to that? What's the predicted outcome of the final product if that change occurs? And then you get to a point where you have to do it manually, where somebody has to spend two, three, four, 5 hours digging through the information, going to the literature to get down to the handful that ultimately gets returned back to the clinic. So here is that millions of variants all the way down to the handful. This is just some details about the specific levels of filtering that they take the data through. And right about here is where you begin looking at this manual route. You may have 200 or 300 that you've got to manually work your way through. Individuals that are very well trained, that know their genome, that know genomes like the back of their hand, can move through this relatively quickly. You and I would, this would be a really overwhelming term project. We would spend a whole lot of time digging through bit by bit. When you are analyzing variants, there's a set of final labels that are applied to the variant in terms of how likely that DNA change is to be pathogenic, the disease-causing, or benign. And so there's this spectrum from benign, likely benign, I'm going to skip variant of uncertain significance for a second, likely pathogenic, and pathogenic. And there's a whole set of rules. There's a really complicated metric. It makes the tax code look like a walk in the park of all the data that you have to look at in order to determine if a DNA change is pathogenic, likely pathogenic, or so on. And the computer can do some of this, but there's a lot of interpretation around that. A group of labs around the country that do this work recently competed in what was humorously termed the bake-off, where they were all given a set of variants and they were all asked to apply this criteria to see if everybody came up with the same results. And the first time they all worked on this, they did not have great agreement. I think it was like they agreed on about 70% of the variants, maybe even less than that. Once they sat down and started talking through, how do you apply this rule? Oh, I apply this rule in a very different way. And they came up with some consistent ways to apply the rules. The consistency went way up. So now there are fewer differences in how we interpret. But you start with a set of variants. I'm giving you three right here, three that have been recently seen in one of our studies at Hudson Alpha. Each one of these is a gene. In parentheses below it is the consequence, the change. So the first letter is an amino acid code. The number is which amino acid in the sequence is changed. And the second letter is what the amino acid became. And you have to apply these criteria to say, okay, well, SCN1A, that's likely benign. If we saw that in somebody, we would not worry about that. ZMYND11, on the other hand, don't you love the names of these genes? ZMYND11, that mutation, that change in this patient, that's likely the cause of their symptoms. That's pathogenic. That's reportable. That is the answer. And then we've got this section in the center, the set D5, variants of uncertain significance. That means we don't have enough data yet to say where it falls. So there's some information that leads us to believe it's not benign, but there's not enough evidence that would make us say, yeah, this is pathogenic. And so over time, as we accumulate more information, we then have a better chance of moving things out of variants of uncertain significance and into other categories. The field changes so quickly that if you went back and looked at your variants of uncertain significance every 6 months to a year, a number of them, a significant number of them, are going to shift out to one end or the other. So again, this comes back, Mary, to my answer to you. The interpretation of the genome is continually improving, and the information you get today is different from the information that you're going to get in the future. Yes, sir? Yeah, so your question, I think I heard it right, correct me if I'm wrong, was we talked last week about that sometimes you've got changes in a gene and sometimes you've got changes in regions that regulate it that are way far away. And sometimes there are genes that we don't have a good sense of what they do yet. So how do you know that the information you've got is your causative factor? And what happens, how do you know that this other variant isn't actually also an important gene, but we just don't know the data around it yet? Is that a pretty fair summary? Okay. Yeah, it's that one, that's the cause versus that one. So it requires a pretty good understanding of the function of a gene, seeing, being able to show computationally that this change in the gene actually, we predict it changes the structure of the protein, and then often going all the way down to some functional lab work that shows that in a cell line or in a model system like a fish or a mouse, this mutation actually leads to a set of, it leads to a functional difference. The challenge is we have a whole lot more variants than we have that level of science. So all the variants that we find, a number of them land in variant of unknown significance or likely pathogenic, but really variant of insignificance. We need more functional data. So that's part of why it's really important that you've got a strong research group that is continually analyzing these variants, building predictive models, running functional studies, so they can report back and say, yeah, the evidence is strong enough that it really is this. And sometimes we get not a variant of unknown significance, we get a gene of uncertain significance. We don't even know what this gene does. We have no data around it. Again, our ability to look at sequence is outstripping our ability to understand what the variants mean.
Question. Can you go back to your slide? If the patient moves out of the variant of uncertain significance moves to the right or to the left based on new information, does the patient have to
That is an excellent question. If the variant of uncertain significance moves to the right or the left, does the patient, in essence, does the patient get told, or does the patient have to request a reanalysis?
Well, that, and also, if it does move, they're not going to know.
They're not going to know, right.
If they are told, will they say, well, come back in for more testing, you need to do it again, do another panel?
Yeah. Do you have to do it again? Do you have to get your genome sequenced again?
Right.
The answer to those questions depends right now on the policies of each individual group. Let me explain what that means. We routinely go back and reanalyze our variants because the science has changed. We do not do it every day, we do not do it every week, we do it on a regular basis. And if we find something that's changed in our clinical studies, then there's a reporting back out. When patients come in and have their genome sequenced, there's a lot of information that says the interpretation of your genome is based on what we know today. And recognize we may give you information today that will be different in the future. Now, here's part of the challenge. It is not without cost to reanalyze a genome. You don't have to resequence it, but you do have to go back through the analysis. So what kind of model ultimately is going to be set up for reimbursing that? Who's going to pay to have your genome reanalyzed on a regular basis? Are you going to be offered a maintenance plan? I mean, essentially, that's what it is, and every so often your genome is resequenced. Is your insurance company going to cover that? Let's say that I get your genome sequenced and you move away and I lose contact with you, but I routinely reanalyze and I now discover the variant of uncertain significance moves one way or the other. Do I have a responsibility to try to find you and put significant amounts of time and money into recontacting you? So these are, on the one hand, you think the answer would be, of course you want somebody to do this. But this is not as simple as I pushed a button and suddenly the data gets sent back to you. So it is challenging.
Seems like the onus is on the patient.
The onus is on the, well, in some cases, the onus is on the patient. I think when we move, if we move to a more consumer-driven model, you will be asked if you want to pay for ongoing, for recurrent updates that may just be pushed right to your device. Oh, look, I don't know, my app for my genome says there's been some new analysis that's been done. I mean, I really think that's what we're gonna get. Just like your, you know, your iPad gets a little circle with a number in it that says it's time to update, I think you're gonna see that same kind of thing. Yes?
Who keeps it and who owns it?
Who keeps it and who owns it? And who can see it? I promise we will get to those questions in just a few slides. But yes, that's a great question. Who has rights to it? Who has access to it? There is an incredible program here at the Institute. There are actually several incredible programs here at HudsonAlpha focused on genomic medicine and sequencing genomes to give patients answers. One of them is a program called CSER, Clinical Sequencing Exploratory Research. We were one of a handful of sites around the country that 5 years ago were selected to start trying to figure out what this looks like in patient care. Another program that we're a part of is called the Undiagnosed Disease Network. We actually provide the sequencing, the genome sequencing, for other sites that are doing patient interpretation for the Undiagnosed Diseases Network. But both of these fall under, and the work, the patient care at the Smith Family Clinic for Genomic Medicine, and additional sequencing that comes in from other physicians through the clinical services lab, are all geared around trying to use genomic sequencing to end the diagnostic odyssey. And behind me are the names of the faculty at the Institute that are involved in this. And it's a blend of people that do sequencing, that do the informatics work, the filtering, the writing the code to interpret it, the ethicists that are involved in it, the education group that tries to figure out how do we share this information back and forth. It really is team science to do genomic medicine. Here's the results from the CSER project, the Clinical Sequencing Exploratory Research, as of just a couple months ago. This is a really cool project. You'll see a video about it in just a second. This is working with families across North Alabama. We actually now are expanding across the state with Martina Bebben, who is a neurologist here in Huntsville. She's a UAB faculty member. And working with her patient population of individuals that have undiagnosed, unexplained disorders, and then we sequence the families. So we've sequenced the child, and as often as we can, we want to sequence both parents so that we can look to see if I find a change in the child, is that change present in mom and dad, and do mom and dad share those symptoms, or is that a brand new variant that arose in the egg or sperm that led to that child? 440 children we've worked with, and in about 27%, we've actually found the cause of the disorder. And remember, these are people that have gone through test after test after test. This is not the first time they're coming up asking for a test. These are people that are the, we have no answers for you. So a quarter of the time, we have now found their answer. Now, in many cases, that doesn't yet change the patient's care. I want to be clear about that. Again, our ability to give you answers still outstrips the biology and our understanding of it and how that changes care. But having a name is so powerful for so many of these families. In about 12%, we've got variants of uncertain significance. Again, that number continually changes as more data comes out and we take variants of uncertain significance and shift them one way or another. But we still have 61% of these families that we don't have answers for them yet. And that's frustrating. I think that number, that percentage, will become smaller as we learn more about changes in our genome and we better identify things. But if I would be making up a story if I told you that we're going to take that number all the way down to zero. There are some times when we have sets of symptoms that don't have easily identifiable causes. They may be environmental. They may be multiple genes, each on their own, not something we would pick up as being potentially problematic. So we're really working with, yes, tough cases, but we've got to figure out if and how we crack the other 61% of answers. And then we have to figure out what it means to integrate it into patient care. How do you say, okay, how does this alter your risk? Does this mean this is the answer for your disease? Does this mean this is a part of the answer for your disease? Does this mean you're at a higher risk for disease? What's the difference between a lifetime risk of 90% of developing the disease and a lifetime risk of 20% of developing the disease? And would you behave differently given a 90% versus a 20% answer? How do we figure out how to match the mutation and the therapy? You'll hear a lot about that next week when we talk about cancer genetic testing. That's the place where knowing the mutations in the cancer really can drive the specific therapy. I want you to watch a video about one of the families in the CSER study. You'll hear from Dr. Greg Cooper, who leads the CSER program. You'll hear from Dr. Martina Bebben, and you'll hear from the mom of this young girl that was part of the CSER program and actually got an answer.
She was kind of like a puzzle. We had pieces here. We could say motor disorder, speech and language disorder, verbal apraxia, still not toilet trained, but it was like something's got to pull this together. You just knew it. I mean, we just knew in our hearts that there was something else going on.
So this is a project here at Hudson Alpha. It's a research and clinical project that we are working on, and our goal is to diagnose children that have unexplained neurological diseases.
She never really had medical issues, like, you know, heart problems or anything that you would link together with a genetic condition. I can remember she was probably about 5 months old, and I was looking at speech charts, and I was thinking, oh, she should be making more sounds by now.
So she was one of the first patients that I was able to request and offer them their participation.
She's 5 years old. I know it's not a delay anymore. I mean, this is a full-blown disorder. The teachers had told me, if you don't get a better diagnosis, we're going to label her as intellectual disability.
And our goal is to use the power of DNA sequencing, of whole genome sequencing, essentially looking at every piece of a child's genetic code. And we try to find genetic explanations for the symptoms that the child is dealing with.
They found that a specific gene had a mutation that correlates with Cornelia DeLange syndrome.
And this is, I think, a very clear example of the value of genetic testing and really how it can end the diagnostic odyssey for a lot of these families. A lot of times that really helps frame the educational approach, the treatment approach, and sometimes will offer therapies that we didn't know should be implemented for that patient.
We had already accepted that. This has been a long journey for us, so we were thrilled with some answers. We're all on the same page now.
You know, the estimate is something like 1-2% of children have a significant cognitive or physical disability that very likely has a genetic, at least a contributory genetic factor underlying it. And so our goal is to reach as many of them as possible. And so our expansion effort is really designed to go across the entire state and essentially reach out to every family in Alabama that might be affected.
We're just glad to get answers. You know, we can deal with whatever. But to get an answer that puts it all together was, this is what we needed. We needed that for our family in general.
That's a story of a family that knew something wasn't right, didn't have an answer. Genomic sequencing identified a disorder called Cornelia DeLange syndrome. They now have answers. They have a name. They also have a support group of other individuals who have children with the same disorder that they can now reach out to and be a part of. The number of the power of an answer is something that I think we should never underestimate, how important it is to be able to have answers. And then you can stop asking why and did I do something. That's powerful. So the next piece about this, once I've sequenced it, once I've looked at the variant, once I've figured out how to incorporate this into clinical care, is your genome gives you information about other things that may be important down the road, things that can shape tomorrow. Something called secondary findings. So when I'm sequencing through a genome, and by the way, did you see that panel of really young individuals that were seated around the table in that video? Yeah, those are DNA variant rock stars. They know genomes inside and out. They dig deep to try to get answers, and they are like dogs with bones. They do not let it go until they get as much information as they can. And they're really young, really young. And they know biology, and many of them know computers and informatics as well. Really hot field, bioinformatics, that merger of the two. Knowing the informatics, doing some of the coding, being able to interpret the variants. All right, secondary findings. Secondary findings mean I've identified something in the genome that is not relevant to the specific symptoms that you came in looking for answers on. The primary finding for the family you just saw was the diagnosis of Cornelia de Lange. But I may also see other things in their genome of the child or of the parents, because remember, in as many cases as possible for this study, we're sequencing mom and dad, that are clinically important, but not the reason why you came in to have genomes sequenced. And what do you do with secondary findings? Well, the first thing you do is ask if the family wants to know secondary findings, because they may not want to know secondary findings. There are some secondary findings that people believe you have a responsibility to give them even if they don't want it. So there's an autonomy, who has rights around who gets secondary findings. What happens to your data? Where does your data live? Who has access to your data? How do you store your data safely? How do you protect your data? And how do we tie that, or how do we deal with the tension of, if we can put at least some of your data, especially the findings, into databases that other scientists can access, it makes all of the job, it makes the job of analyzing it easier for everybody. So how do we do that in a way that protects your identity if you give permission to do that sort of thing? So secondary findings from the CSER project that we just talked about, this is looking at 705 parents of kids. In about 8% of the cases, we actually identify a secondary finding. And that can be things like, we've identified a mutation in a gene that gives you a 70% lifetime risk of developing colon cancer. Or we've identified a variant that when you go into surgery, you should not have this specific type of anesthesia because your body temperature will rise so quickly that you are in danger of dying on the operating table. Or you are at risk of having a high likelihood of having a cardiomyopathy, having a heart abnormality based on a piece of genetic information. Those are really important secondary findings that have important clinical implications. But people may not be aware that that kind of information can be uncovered because they're thinking, I'm going in to try to get an understanding of what's going on with this set of symptoms or why my child has this specific disorder. So there's a lot of education and informed consent and helping people be aware of what you may find. And individuals should be, in many cases, able to say, I want this kind of secondary finding. I don't want this kind of secondary finding. I don't want you to give me, for example, I don't want you to give me information about adult onset disorders for which there is no treatment for. Don't tell me that information. Other people would say, tell me that information because I need to know because I'm going to make different life choices if I know I have a high risk for that. Now again, you see only 8%. Everybody who comes through is not coming out with lots of secondary findings. Most of us have boring genomes. And generally, we don't like to think of ourselves as boring, but boring genomes is a good thing. It really is a good thing. It's good not to be exceptional in this instance. And then how do you integrate this into the broader system? Like your electronic health record. Many of you, all of you probably, have interacted with multiple different electronic health records, and there's a lot of challenges around how those electronic health records work, how you gather information. You cannot put 6 million DNA variants in your electronic health record. You also cannot, in most electronic health records, put in a list of the 50 variants that we think need to be paid attention to, and automatically it will go out and analyze the new research on those variants and update your electronic health record. You are in many cases putting in a faxed in copy of the paper report of the analysis of the genome. So it's static. It is not something that you can easily interpret. It will not cross-link that when you go to your cardiologist, it will automatically flag and say, hey, here are some variants you should pay attention to. Be great if we could get that kind of system, that kind of interactivity. But right now, we generally don't have it. It really is a faxed copy of your paper report. How do you store and use and protect that as well? How do you reimburse for that? Right now, by and large, you pay for this on your own. How much does it cost to have your genome sequenced? Somewhere in the neighborhood of $6,000 to $8,000 total, all in. If you're sequencing the entire genome. Now, if you're just doing one gene test or if you're just doing one site test, that's a different cost. But if you're having your genome sequenced, so for many of you, I was having a conversation with George earlier, and we were remarking that that's, for many of us, above the price limit of an impulse buy. But it won't be at that price limit forever. It continues to change as we continue to get better. And at some point, for some of you, the metric is already, hey, I'm intrigued enough, I want to know enough, I'm willing to step into that realm. For others of you, it's, I'm going to wait until that comes down to something that's in the hundreds instead of the thousands. We're going to talk more about that next week with a concept of an elective genome and what that might look like. But right now, reimbursement's challenging. In some medical cases, you can get an insurer to pay for a genome or an exome sequence. But in many, many cases, it still is relying on philanthropy, private donor dollars, or the individual writing a check and having tons of bake sales and car washes to raise money to have their genome analyzed. And then there's a whole set of ELSI issues, ethical, legal, social issues, which I'm going to hit as we wrap up. Genetic discrimination. Can your genetic information be used against you? The Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, which was actually signed the day we had our grand opening at HudsonAlpha, it was approved by Congress the day we had our grand opening, says you cannot be denied health coverage, health insurance coverage, or employment based on your genetic information. Your genetic information cannot be used against you to deny you insurance or to deny you employment. Now, that there's a lot of things that does not say. It does not say it won't impact your rates. It does not say it won't impact your ability to get life insurance or disability insurance. So there is one part that's covered, but there are a lot of other pieces that aren't. And people who are going to have their genome sequenced may need to think about, before they do that, going out and getting supplemental life insurance or disability insurance before they've got that information in front of them. If you're asking your insurance company to pay to have your genome sequenced, your insurance company has a right to see that information. It impacts your risks, just like if you were to tell the insurance company, yeah, I skydive and I ride motorcycles, and I actually skydive riding a motorcycle. That's important information that they will probably use to determine what your level of coverage and rates should be. Your genome has some of that same information. Now, in general, most insurance companies will say, we haven't figured out enough about the genome to really know how to use that. But at some point, we will. And we're going to reach a point, at least until we've figured out what everybody has, that it's going to be tricky in how we use that information. Unexpected results, this is kind of like secondary findings. This is when you thought you were going in for one thing and you discovered something else, like carrier status or future disease risk like cancer or non-paternity. You can uncover that one parent is not, who you thought was a parent is biologically not a parent. You have to have those conversations going into it. People have to know that up front. Otherwise, they're going to get hit in the face with it, and nobody told them that could be an issue. Individual laboratories generally have to determine how they handle these kinds of results and who the patient or the participant who has a choice to opt in or opt out to that kind of information. And this really becomes a tug of war between doing good by giving you information that might be important to your health and respecting your autonomy and your right not to know and to not do any harm by giving you information that could inadvertently cause harm to your family and your social structure. Let's talk about testing minors. Historically, the rules have been that you do not test minors for adult onset conditions, that we will not test a 12-year-old and give them information about their risk of developing cancer as an adult. Sequencing their entire genome means we get that information, and it is changing that landscape. So what does that mean? How do you have that conversation with a 12-year-old? Do you want this information? Does it automatically get given to the parents? Because if the parents say, yes, I want it, that precludes the child from later on saying, no, I didn't want it. So how are you How are you making those decisions about who has the right to know information, especially in the instance of minors? And then access to sequencing. I told you, many insurance companies don't reimburse. So right now, access to having your genome sequenced is limited to those that can pay for it or can raise the funds or that qualify for a research program that can cover those funds. So that's not equitably distributed. So how do we think about how we do equitable distribution? Okay, that was like a fire hydrant of content around diagnostic testing and the ethical challenges that are around it. Next week, we're going to talk about cancer testing. We're going to talk about complex disease pharmacotesting, pharmacogenomics, and what that means. Some of you in the room have a piece of paper in your wallet or in your purse that has pharmacogenetic information that your physician ordered or that somebody ordered on you that you and your physician may not exactly know how to interpret. We're going to talk about some of that as well. We're also going to have a really interesting conversation that has nothing at all to do with these topics, but falls under that heading of, did you know? So bring your curiosity cap with you when we come back next week on the 21st. So have a good night, everybody. Happy Valentine's Day. Thank you for being here.